Hi, this is Graham from Jenham's Astro. People often ask me what telescope they should buy if they want to get into astrophotography. What I normally say to them is they should buy a small refractor telescope, something maybe 70mm in size for the aperture, maybe 70 or 80mm, and they should try to buy one that's so-called achromat or a semi-achromat. And that means one where the main objective lens is made of glass that brings all the wavelengths of light to focus around the same point. Now these telescopes, there's a wide range of these telescopes available, lots of different brands. In the UK, you're probably talking about a price of £300 upwards, but the sky's the limit basically. You can spend an awful lot of money. So I suggest that they buy a telescope like that, a small low dispersion glass refractor, and that they put that onto a lightweight mount. But got to thinking whether there was an alternative. Is it possible to learn the basics of astrophotography using an even cheaper optical tube than one of those? And maybe using one that is an achromat. So typically, achromatic telescopes, these are ones which don't have this clever glass. So they normally get over the problems that can cause in terms of seeing false colour within the image, or so-called chromatic aberration. They get over this by having long focal lengths. So these things look like long pipes really, and they're the traditional old-fashioned view of telescopes. But it is possible to take another route. So this video does just that, and it looks at a small achromatic refractor. So this is the short tube 80, which is a model that's been available branded under quite a few different names for a long time. It's currently branded, for example, as the Star Travel 80. So in this video, we're going to have a look at this refractor, which on the face of it isn't very promising as a piece of equipment to use for astrophotography. And we're going to see if we can get some decent images. Okay, so the short tube 80. So basically, if you buy one of these new, just the tube assembly and the fittings that it comes with, in the UK, it's around £100. They've been around for a long time, so you can find these telescopes used maybe from around £60 on an auction site. And as long as you're careful when you check out a scope like that, buy it from a reputable seller, then fingers crossed, they're fairly robust scopes. They should be okay. So what do we know? It's, as the name suggests, has a lens that is 80mm in diameter, and it has a focal length of 400mm. That is to say, there's 400mm between the lens and the point where the light comes into focus. So you can see it's about the actual tube. When the light bends around here, around this 90 degrees, then it's a foot and a little bit long. It's got a focal ratio of f5. That means that the focal length, that 400mm, divide that by the aperture and you get 5. So it's an f5, or a fast 80mm refractor. It weighs about 1.8 kilos. And if you compare that to a weight of a digital SLR, the sort of thing we're going to be using in this video, that weighs about 0.7 kilos. So the whole setup ready to sit on a mount is going to be around 2.5 kilos. So it's quite lightweight, even though it's mechanically quite a sound item, lots of metal, quite chunky, but still only 2.5 kilos all in with the camera. So these telescopes are generally supplied with tube rings, which are these items here, which clamp around the outside of the tube, and they'll often have some kind of bar here, dovetail bar, which is used to mount the scope onto the telescope mount. This particular one has a red dot finder, although you sometimes see optical finders, and they can be removed and changed out. It comes with a standard bracket here to fit a different finder. The focuser is pretty basic. It is a rack and pinion focuser here. You can see it single speed, which is to say it doesn't have a feature that you get on more sophisticated telescopes where you can have a fine 1/10th scale focusing being very key in astrophotography. But it's a basic focuser and it has quite a good feel. It's quite solid. Doesn't feel like it wants to move around very much. And it also, quite importantly for astrophotography, has a screw here that allows you to tension the focuser. So if you've got a camera hanging off this, then you can tighten it all down and nothing really moves. So what would you need to do if you had a mount and you had a camera? What would you do to get started with this scope? Well, I'm not going to go into the details of the techniques for actually taking the photo. All I'm really going to cover is how you'd attach the camera. Okay, so if you've got your digital SLR, then the first thing you're going to need is one of these, which is a T-ring, which you buy one of these. It has the bayonet mount for your particular camera type on one side, and then there's a standard thread size on the other. So you get one of those. This is a Canon camera, and you click it on like that. Now, it seems that that standard thread is conveniently already provided for you on the back of the short tube 80. So there's a thread here which actually is the same as the thread on the inside of this T-ring. So I could actually screw the camera directly onto the focuser, and that would appear to give a really firm mounting arrangement. The problem is that often, in order to actually focus a camera, so imagine you're focusing, as we would say, at infinity, so we're focusing on an object a very long way away, a star, for example, or the moon, in order to actually bring this arrangement of camera and telescope into focus, you need to put some more distance between the sensor in the camera and the back of the telescope. You can't actually find that focus point even if you have the focuser fully extended like that. So if you imagine you could screw it in like that, it won't quite reach focus. You won't be able to bring the image into focus. In fact, in reality, you need to separate them by another couple of centimeters. So if you buy one of these used, you've got to make sure you look out for whether it has one of these things, which is called an extension tube. If not, you can buy one for a few pounds, and it simply slots into the focuser like so, and you tighten it down, and allows you then to attach the camera where you want it to go. So now you need to put another 1¼-inch adapter that screws into your T-ring like that, and then finally you can attach that into the extension tube at the back of the telescope. So that seems a bit of a pain, but it's quite common with small refractors like this. Basically, they're designed so that normally they bring the light into focus when you have an eyepiece and a diagonal. So imagine you're looking at a star. Visually, you're observing something up high in the sky. So you have one of these 90 degree diagonals to bend the light and make it more comfortable. But basically, if this is the arrangement when the star comes into focus, if you imagine taking away all the extra focal length of light bouncing around that diagonal, and you go to put your camera sensor at the same place that your eye was, and you can see that in fact you need the camera sensor to be here and not here. So just basically be aware, you're probably going to need an extension tube. Quite common with these sorts of telescopes, even more expensive ones. So we're ready to go. We're going to put this arrangement, the camera and the telescope, onto an equatorial mount, one that has a drive to move it in the right ascension axis. And we're going to just see what kind of quality of image we can get. So I'm going to choose a range of targets and take a look at the results. And basically, the objective is to see, is this telescope good enough so that you can get your skills building up on astrophotography? Is it the weak link, or would you be the weak link if you come into astrophotography and you choose to take the route of using a very basic, very simple optical tube like this? So let's give it a go and see how well it performs. So the first target I've looked at is the planet Venus. This is taken with the ST80 and a 2x Barlow using a digital SLR. Now the reason you can see me over on the side of the frame is because, well, there's lots of space. This object doesn't fill the frame, nowhere near. So this is Venus. This is what you'll see if you video it with a digital SLR or if you take a still image with that setup of telescope and Barlow. And if we zoom in, you get a rainbow. So basically, Venus is a very bright target. At the moment when I took this shot, it's high in the sky, so we're not looking through a lot of atmosphere. Still, it's so bright, the ST80's short focal ratio has resulted in us getting all this chromatic aberration. So we're really seeing this false color, separation of the wavelengths of light, and really, it isn't very good. So I'd say not only is a digital SLR not really suited to photograph the planets with a scope of this sort of focal length, but the scope itself isn't really suitable for photographing a bright planet. So moving on to the moon, again with a 2x Barlow, I think this frame's probably got just about the right exposure so that you can see some detail in the craters. And if we zoom in, then the edge of the moon, there's a tiny bit of colour evident, but it's not what I would call significant, not distracting. If we were to increase the exposure a little bit, and then we have another look, we're starting to see some colour fringing here. We're starting to see a little bit of violet red. And then if we go further again, so this time we try and capture a bit of earthshine, longer exposure, higher gain on the camera. Now, whilst we can see the other side of the moon, it's quite a nice image in that respect, if we zoom in, we've got quite a lot of colour, purple fringing, evident at the edge of the moon. So it's not done too badly, I'd say. In these conditions, the sky wasn't very dark, so that you get more effect noticeable when the moon was high in the sky and at a different phase and in a fully dark sky. But still, you start to see a bit of chromatic aberration. But certainly, the ST80 can give you pretty nice views of the moon, but they're not perfect. Moving on to deep sky objects, this is the Perseus double cluster. So this image is taken from 10 30-second frames. Now 30 seconds is a very achievable short duration that you should be able to get from a lightweight equatorial mount if you've done a half-decent polar alignment. I think you can see that this shows the ST80 is capable of achieving nice, small, well-defined star images across the frame of the digital SLR, and it's also rendering some nice colour in the stars. A different type of object now, this is Messier 3, a globular cluster. Slightly more exposure this time, reasonably well defined, very small object. So this is a crop of the overall frame, but I think you can see this object gets a bit overlooked in place of M13, some other globulars nearby, but I think it's produced a good image. This is Messier 57, the Ring Nebula. Now, when I took this shot, this stack of frames, the Ring Nebula was really low in the sky. It was just rising in the east. So it's quite a challenge to get an image of this. So I've used lots of short frames at a faster film speed or camera speed. Something more ambitious, this is the Flaming Star Nebula in Auriga. So this shows that you can record nice nebulosity with a bit of practice, quite a lot of exposure time to capture this object and a little work in post-processing. And then very famous pair of galaxies, Messier 81 and 82 in Ursa Major. Again, quite a challenge. Objects high in the sky, which is good. Quite a lot of exposure time. More exposure on galaxies gives you a better image. That's true on any telescope, whether it be an ST80 or a very expensive refractor or reflector. Okay, so conclusions. Would I recommend you have a go at astrophotography using something like this ST80 or Star Travel 80 or an equivalent refractor telescope? Well, I think the answer has to be yes. If you can pick one of these up for not very much, and you already have the rest of the equipment. That is to say, maybe have an equatorial mount that you've got with a different telescope, and you've already got a digital SLR, then this is a good way, this sort of telescope is a good way to get into astrophotography. Put your toe into it, if you like, and see how you get on. You can definitely get credible images with this scope. The only things it really falls down on are the objects perhaps where, that you'd expect, where the focal ratio and the achromatic lens are its weak points. So if you try to look at Venus, as we've seen, it's not going to give you a good result. You're going to get a lot of fringing. It's not going to be very pleasant. You're not going to see a white planet. You're going to see a planet with purple haze on one side and red or another colour on the other side. It's a bit more looking like a rainbow. So if you avoid very bright objects like that, the moon's okay, although you might have to put up with that sort of fringing around the edge of the moon. Otherwise, for deep sky objects, so looking at nebulae, clusters, galaxies even, when you get a bit more experience, then this short tube 80 can produce some really good results. So I'd say if you get an opportunity to pick one of these up, maybe you've got a reflector telescope or something at the moment that you don't really know how to use and it's a bit unwieldy, this is an option to see whether you're going to like astrophotography and you're not really committing a large amount of money. So short tube 80, definitely better than its price suggests. I suggest you give it a try and get some good results. Okay, I hope it's been useful. Thanks for watching, and please subscribe to Jenham's Astro YouTube channel if you'd like to see more videos like this. Bye for now.